Thank you everyone for coming down. I'm Alex Bass from Sites, and you are?
Helen Banks from ASICS. And hi everybody.
And Helen, what do you do at ASICS?
Well, when I'm not scrambling on the floor sorting out samples, I'm actually the marketing manager for the JD Group.
What's your entire title? It's quite a mouthful, isn't it?
Let me have a look. European Marketing Account Manager at ASICS, and my customer is Sites. So, yeah.
So, obviously at Paris Fashion Week, it's probably best to start with your journey to how you got to your position. So, you started at Leeds Beckett University, right?
Started a bit before that. I didn't actually go to Leeds Beckett University until I was 25. So up to that point, I was a lot more interested in just going out partying and going on quite a few raids in Leeds. But we won't talk about that here and now. So I decided to go to uni, and my degree was marketing with food. So what on earth am I doing here now? Well, the first part of my career was spent at the co-op, and I had a whole range of roles at the co-op, from TV through to print media, radio, and working on the co-op's loyalty scheme. And also, as you probably know, the co-op, I'm not here to promote the co-op, by the way, everyone, but the co-op is a really ethical company with a really strong social responsibility part to it. So yeah, I really enjoyed working at the co-op. And then I had a burning desire to get into fashion. Do you want me to carry on?
Yeah, go for it, go for it. You're doing a good job.
So, in order to move from retail marketing into fashion, I had to go through a kind of personal rebranding process because I didn't really have the credentials on paper that I could just walk into a fashion role. But on the other hand, I was really passionate about what I was interested in and knew what I wanted to do. But I needed to really reframe that so that businesses would really know why they wanted to employ me, basically. So,
how difficult did you find it to kind of rebrand yourself, from kind of like food retail or food kind of marketing, sorry, into fashion?
Yeah, it's funny. I think I actually did go on a personal branding course. I always think it's helpful to have a mentor or a coach, and notice how Yorkshire said coach there. And so she helped me to recognise the transferable skills that I actually had. So the amount of knowledge that I'd got from working at the cooperative for so many years and managing agencies, doing photo shoots and so on, all of that transferable knowledge and working processes was just as relevant. And actually, what they were seeking was somebody with a bit of spark and some personality. So hopefully that came through. And because I was being a more authentic version of myself and doing what I really wanted to do, it enabled me to really find that enthusiasm and power to just go into interviews and sell myself really.
So then what was your first step into kind of fashion then?
My first step was actually working as a PR manager for Boohoo.
Oh, small brand? No, well, just kidding, massive brand.
Yeah, and even gone on to much bigger and better things, and they're now an international brand. And that's fast fashion and really an exciting kind of place to work, but really quite a big cultural difference between the co-op and then Boohoo, but a really fun environment with massive opportunities for young people, I'd say, and a really good talent recruitment program as well. So anyway, let's go on to my favourite brand.
Yeah, so now you're at ASICS. Yeah. Is it ASICS or ASICS? I know it's said differently around the world.
You say ASICS, I say. I say, oh, I can feel a song coming. I say ASICS, but I think it depends where in the world you're from, because my French colleagues would say ASICS.
Fair enough.
Have we got any other Yorkshire people in the room today? No?
No, I'm the only one. So you're at Asics now, and you're obviously in this huge marketing role, which you know you have one of the biggest accounts for you, with Size and JD and whatnot. What does that kind of entail on a day-to-day basis?
Well, a lot of travelling. The European headquarters of Asics is in Amsterdam, and we've just got a brand new state-of-the-art sustainable building in Amsterdam. You probably can see that anywhere on LinkedIn if you look up Asics. I've lost my train of thought, sorry, that's just...
So what is your kind of day-to-day entail?
So I do a lot of stakeholder management and looking after the marketing plans for each of my three accounts. So I look after Foot Patrol, which has stores in London and
Paris.
Yeah, and then we've got Size with the flagship door in Canopy Street just down the road there. And then I look after the whole of the JD group, the Asics account within the JD group across Europe.
And how difficult is it for you in terms of kind of deciphering which consumer is which? Because obviously not all products will go to all doors, will it?
No, not at all. And for Asics, as a challenger brand, that is a really big challenge for us to overcome and to really get close to the customer and understand what the changing needs and desires are of the customer and how we can compete with the likes of the top two brands who I'm not going to mention, but we're talking about here in sportswear. But I think that makes it more exciting, because if you're at the forefront of the marketplace, then what are you chasing after? But for me, it makes it really exciting because there's so many different facets of assets that we need to develop and grow. So I really enjoy it.
So you mentioned before that you have a brand new headquarters that's been built in Amsterdam, which is a sustainable headquarters.
Yeah, now, you're welcome anytime you like.
Thank you. So sustainability is obviously a bit of a sexy topic at the moment. Everyone's kind of talking about it.
Is it sexy?
It's a difficult way to describe it, but everybody's talking about sustainability and how we can do more. From an Asics perspective, what is it that you guys are doing?
Well, I think that we're playing our part in this, and Asics is a Japanese company, and we work on a philosophy of Kaizen. Does anybody know what Kaizen means? It's about a process of continuous improvement. So, like a lot of Japanese, the Japanese culture, we're quite humble. So we are making huge improvements behind the scenes, but we're not going about shouting about it because we think that we're just continually improving. But just to highlight a couple of things that we're doing, we've got all recyclable materials in the head office. And I think we're working to a point where over 50% of our apparel range is now made from recycled nylon or recycled sports wear. So I think they're really good points, but I don't think we're at a stage where we're really shouting about them overtly, but we do a lot of work on corporate social responsibility to ensure that it's an improving picture.
You mentioned social responsibility, and it's something that you have somewhat of a background in as well, isn't it?
Yeah, excuse me, I just need to blow my nose.
I'm not going to sneeze, don't worry.
So corporate social responsibility and sustainability. I think for me, the sustainability and then social responsibility is kind of the bigger picture of what businesses can do to really give back. And that sounds a little bit worthy, but really, we are running a business. So we do need to think about the commerciality of it and the bottom line when you're in business. But I think more and more going forward, businesses will be more focused on sustainability and social responsibility, because as people become more educated and understanding what the dramatic impact of climate change is that's not going to go away, I think younger children, kids who are coming up from high school now, are going to really demand those changes. From brands that they buy from.
What do you think to kind of programs where potentially in the future we could have instances of when we buy a shoe, we could then take that shoe back to the retailer for it to be recycled in order to receive a newer product? I think something like that would work at Asics. especially with running shoes, so you could run a certain amount of miles in a shoe and then, you know, kind of recycle that shoe with the brand and then be kind of rewarded with a new one. Would that be something that would work?
I think it's anything like that is a really good idea, and there are a lot of retailers already doing schemes where you take your clothing back to the store and you either get a £5 or €5 voucher to go towards another item of clothing. But is that really, you know, you could argue that it's quite superficial and what happens to those garments in the end. And I think there's definitely a need to move towards a circular economy. And we're not there yet, but I think people are definitely sitting up and taking more notice of that. But just to go back to your point, I don't know whether we would do that at Asics, if I'm really honest, but I know that our corporate social responsibility team are looking at all kinds of schemes where you know, we recycle products and so on. But ultimately, we just all need to stop buying quite as much and think about the quality of the products that we buy. And you know, when you're buying something, are you just buying it for the sake of it, or are you buying it because you really want it? Or so I guess to just think about how I now buy things is, do I really want it, and is it going to really enhance what I'm wearing? And also, have I got something else that's better? And if I have, then why am I buying it? So it's just a change in attitudes.
Do you think it's something that a lot of the designers and the students and the graduates here have kind of projects on display? Do you think it's something that they should have in mind going forward with their designs?
I've already seen today that they definitely do have, yeah. I mean, there's all kinds of ways in things are developing, that things are developing quite rapidly. So for example, wearable tech, and that's something that Asics are looking at as well. So yeah.
One thing I'd always kind of thought about from a brand's perspective is, you know, the boxes, the shoe boxes. It's obviously such a kind of, say, waste of cardboard, if you like, but I've always kind of struggled as to why no brand has ever tried just not giving out shoe boxes.
I think we're quite a step away from that at the moment, but I do think it's a good idea of, you know, making the materials much lighter than they are at the moment, and I think there's generally a shift towards that. But certainly if we could have some kind of recycled packaging that's a bag that makes it more attractive to and functional, something that you actually want to carry around with you and want to use as part of your everyday ensemble, then yeah, good idea. In fact, I think Matt just pinched that from you.
No worries. So obviously you mentioned that you started your academic journey slightly later at about 25. Do you think that benefited you in the long run?
I think it benefited me just because of the type of personality I am, and also at the time I wasn't getting a huge amount of support from family members in terms of that encouragement to go to university. I think there are a lot more options open to young people now, but I think that from my perspective it seems like there's an awful lot more intense competition now. So I do think young people today, I'm calling everybody young people, and what I mean is students and graduates who are leaving uni and leaving their fashion courses and so on, I think it's a lot more difficult, and perhaps that's the speed and the dynamic environment that we're living in, and also the onset of social media has been absolutely vast. So
from someone within your position as, you know, as European marketing account manager, how important are events like this to, you know, people like yourselves and brands like Asics as well?
Well, I've always enjoyed taking part in events like this, and I think it's really valuable, but I think it's also good to get for us to get feedback from people who attend these kind of events as well. It's not just got to be a one-way dialogue, we have to have an interaction, and it's good for us to come in from industry and be able to have an opportunity to sell our brands to you, but also young people and graduates of the future who are coming into industry now and entering the economy. It's really important to get their opinions and listen to what they've got to say. And by the talented lot of people here, as we've seen today, haven't we?
Yeah, I suppose, you know, the fresh ideas are always really helpful for brands like yourselves. Is it something that, is graduate freshman something that you could see ASICS taking a bigger step into going forward? Do you think there should be more brands here with kind of, almost not like recruiting, but you know, just to say, this is who we are, this is what we offer. Because you know, you see a lot of fashion brands, especially like supermarkets, you've got Sainsbury's, TU, George and Asda. Is it something that you think more sportswear companies should be involved in?
Yes. Do you want to say a bit more about that?
I mean, I suppose, what would you be looking for from an ASICS perspective from a graduate?
Yeah, okay. So, on a personal level, what I'd be looking for is someone with a bit of a spark, someone who is authentically showing me themselves, not just trying to be really corporate and saying the things that they've read in a textbook or heard on a podcast or a, you know, a TED talk. I want to know what you've got to say for yourself. I want to hear about your thesis or your portfolio. I want to see some passion. I might not agree with what you've done or what you're saying about yourself, but I want to know that you are your own person and you've got some strength of character and conviction behind the work that you've produced.
So it's important for people to stay true to they are, who they are, even if you don't agree.
Yeah, I think so. And also, not everyone is going to like you. Not everyone likes me. And I found by going to some interviews and realised pretty early on when I've done the groundwork that this ain't going anywhere. And equally, sometimes you just get a rapport with the interview. Like now. Yeah, also I think you always have to present the best version of yourself in your CV, in your portfolio, and of course everyone wants to do that, but it's got to be authentic and true to yourself.
I think also as well, the balance has to be right, doesn't it?
Yeah, so, absolutely.
You know, when you are interviewing, it's almost a case of always selling yourself to the employer, whereas sometimes I think it's worth asking the employer, why should I be working for you?
Absolutely, yeah.
Definitely need to
even
kind of
more so now.
So it's just kind of because I think people need to understand that sometimes it has to be a right fit for yourself as the employer as well as the employee.
Yeah, I'm also interested in what your extracurricular activities, but you know what I mean. Like, I'm interested in what your hobbies are and what your interests are outside of the immediate working environment. But they need to be real. So you know, if you're going to tell me that you have a dinner party every weekend and you like mixing with a themed dinner party every weekend, I'm going to be a bit like, well, really? Is it? So I kind of want to get a feel for who you are as a person, that I need to be real. But also, I think you need to have a commercial mindset as well, because a lot of people in this room will be entering creative industries, but at the same time, you need to be able to harness that creativity and really hone it down so that you can ultimately. Businesses are, they need to make profit either for shareholders or for owners or whatever. And that is reality of business. And we go to work and we want to have a good time and we want to enjoy what we do. But it's important to have that sort of commercial spark as well and be able to put that into practice in the workplace.
What was it about ASICS that kind of drew you in? Because I know a lot of people that work within brands, they always have like a kind of connection to it, and they've always loved the product, or they love what the brand's about. What is it that kind of drew you in?
Well, I've been wearing ASICS and Onyx Super Tiger for quite a while. First went to New York some years ago and I bought a pair of Onyx Super Tiger. I hadn't heard of them at the time, but then it wasn't much longer after that a short-term interim opportunity came up as the sports style marketing manager for the UK with ASICS. So even though it was only a short-term assignment, and perhaps it wasn't quite at the level that I wanted to be at that time, I could see that there were some real benefits to me taking a role with a global brand. So that's what attracted me, and also my interest in fashion, streetwear and sports style and so on, really meant that I already had that connection. But moreover, once I started to really understand ASICS and get into the mindset of working at ASICS, I guess I like that ASICS is Japanese, and what's important to us is the Japanese heritage. I think
that will be something that we shout about even more as we go forward in the future. Our Japanese craftsmanship and also the technology that goes into the ASICS footwear. We've got the IWS over in Kobe in Japan that I've not had the opportunity to go there yet, but I've been to the head office in Tokyo and to the office in Kobe with some of your colleagues from SIDE, and that was an incredible opportunity. So I guess to summarise really, I was attracted by the sportswear industry, but moreover I think that ASICS is a unique brand because of its Japanese heritage and 70 year history that's really authentic and unique.
Yeah, it sounds as though like the ethics and the values of the brand really spoke to you as well, so it's something that you kind of wanted to be a part of. How important would this sort of event as in London Graduate Fashion Week, how important would that have been to you as a graduate? I know it's a slightly different area, obviously you're now doing a marketing role, but how important would something like this have been to you?
I do recall attending them, but at that stage in my development, I think I was still fairly shy and not very developed and not really able to hone my networking skills and relationship building skills. And I think now, again, with social media, LinkedIn and networking events and larger scale events like these, it's really important that you kind of step out of your comfort zone and reach out to people and chat to people who you think, you know, even if it's just somebody who you see while you're having a coffee and you think they look really interesting but you don't know what their background is, you're not on the tube, you know, you're at an event where you're here to network, so just get on and do it, and you never know who you might meet, who you might be sitting next to, who you might get introduced to, and what doors they might open up for you in your career.
So, do you actually have anything at ASICS right now from a graduate or intern perspective that, you know, some of the guys in the audience might be interested in?
Well, funnily you should say that. No, in reality we do actually have three openings for interns or graduates at the moment. We've got one in the sports style division where I work, we've got one in running, and we've got one in apparel. However, what I need to caveat that with, they are based in our Amsterdam office, which is an incredible place to work and spend time in Amsterdam. It can be for 6 to 9 months, and it's kind of a rolling programme, so we don't have a specific time or date, you know, it's not like everyone has to arrive in July and leave on a certain date. It's dependent on the specific position. However, what I would say is that you, as part of the law in the Netherlands, dictates that the person must still be registered with the university. So ideally, it would need to be someone, perhaps on a sandwich course, or someone who's still at the university and then intending to go on to do a further course at that university. So.
So you mentioned there was one in running.
Yes, running. Sports style, which is sports style, you know, the athleisure streetwear kind of part of the business, and also one in apparel.
And how do they differ? So will it be the same kind of internship across all three, or will you be exposed to different things? I know, for example, the size graduate scheme is slightly different, and you know, a lot of it's based around kind of multi-channel and the digital side of things, but you're exposed to every part of the business. Would it be a similar sort of thing?
No, I think in some instances you'll be learning some of those kind of things and spending time with the multi-channel team. However, the way that ASICS is restructured for success for the future and to kind of future-proof ourselves is that we're organised now into three specific categories. So we have the sports style category, we have which is a real growth area. We have running, which is our heartland and our core. ASICS is built on running. And then we've got core performance sports, which apparel would be a part of.
Amazing. Why don't we open it up and see if anybody's got any questions in the audience? Anyone? Oh, hello, there's one right at the back. Don't be shy. Oh, yeah, actually, grab the mic so we can hear you.
Hello.
Tell us who you are.
I can't really hear you. Not working. I'll help. In account management specifically, how much of a routine do you get? Is it very much just like organising meetings?
I think that's a really good question, by the way. Thanks for asking me, because it's given me an opportunity to clarify that, because I didn't really say much about what I actually did. But on account management, in some accounts, you would take the creative and then you would implement it for that specific account. However, for my accounts, they do afford a great deal of creative license, really. And the aspects of that, the role that I really like, is to be able to work alongside Size and the brand team, and we co-create content together. So you'll be able to see on Size channels some of the work that we've done together. So I mentioned before that we went to Japan, and actually you can see the shoe that Alex is wearing here. This was a gel saga that we launched that's specific and exclusive to Size. And as part of that project, we actually travelled to a balloon festival, which was in Japan. And it enabled Size to tell the ASICS story and the story of that shoe through the lens of Size very specifically. So they had unique content to them and to their brand to position them more as an authority on that product. Which really helps us stand out in the marketplace. So to answer that, really, yes, there are some accounts where you have less creativity and it would be more about implementing. But also, I wouldn't say admin, no, because you would be responsible for rolling out the marketing plan for the season. So it would be quite exciting because you would be the cog, if you like, between the brand and the client or the end brand, the customer, I call them.
Any other questions? Don't be shy, guys. You can ask anything. Yeah, there's one there at the front. There's two at the front there, so here we go. Yeah, you can do. Just tell us who you are.
Hi,
Tia.
Nice to
meet
you.
Someone
was
applying for a marketing assistant role, is there anything you're going to CV in terms of experience or in a portfolio in terms of what work display that you'd be looking for a marketing assistant?
Good question.
Well, I like that question.
Can
I
just sort of
think? I feel like it's a bit of an interview now, but I really like.
I
think
you'd
be good.
Yeah. I mean, if you want to
employ
me, I'm not
going to
say no.
Do you have a CV with you?
Of course.
There you go.
I'll come find you. Don't worry.
Right, I'll be looking for a mixture of creative thinking, but also demonstrating that you can do, sorry everyone, mundane tasks as well. Because at a marketing assistant level, I'd want to be able to see some fire and a spark, and even from the CV, the way you've written it and the way you've presented yourself on the CV, I think I'll be able to tell how authentic you've been, because you know, we look at a lot of CVs. But also I'd want you to kind of give me the heads up that you can also cope with some mundane tasks, because let's face it, at marketing assistant level, there are going to be some days when you are just getting through some churn work, and I think that's the case in all industries really, where I referred before to like sorting samples out and so on, and I think you have to expect that at that kind of level, and I'm sure you would, that there are some days when you might be like, oh god, if I look at another pair of trainers again, I'm just, you know. But also then that demonstrates a willingness to persevere and to be able to deliver and see things through and be a finisher. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Thank you very much. Amazing. The gentleman next to you. Hello,
sir.
Who are you?
Hello, everyone. I'm David, and I'm from National Department University. What did you want from your career after graduation, and what do you want now?
Oh, I love that one as well. It's giving me the floor now. So, when I graduated, I was 27, and I got a first in my degree, and I think I got a first because I knew that it was something that I definitely wanted to do, and I was a little bit less bothered about going out and partying. I was really committed. And I also did my dissertation on a subject that at the time I was really interested in. So when I finished, I really wanted to work in some kind of food organisation, and honestly, don't laugh, but what I wanted to do is make ready meals, because at that time you could get all these kind of amazing ready meals that meant I didn't have to cook. They're laughing at me down here. But I think part of that was my creativity as well, that I liked the whole food photography kind of thing and making it look really as tasty as possible. And at that time I was reading a lot of kind of food. I'm always hungry as well. So reading a lot of food magazines and BBC Good Food and all this kind of thing. So I was inspired by the creativity of the food industry, and therefore that's what I wanted to do. So I actually ended up on the co-op's graduate scheme because I went for a few graduate schemes, but ultimately when I went to meet them informally when I got the job, they were the group of people that really connected, and I felt culturally more like I would fit in there. So I ended up in Manchester.
And then what do you want to do now?
What do I want to do now? Okay, so I love working in Amsterdam, but as I'm based in Manchester and I've got three kids in Manchester, it is quite a relentless schedule, but I really enjoy it. I feel like working with a young team, a young dynamic and creative team, is really inspiring, and I get to work with all these guys from Size and JD Sports as well, and that's fabulous. But ultimately, I'm going to set up my own brand, and potentially, I don't know if the ASIC CEO's listening to this, but my daughter is a dancer, she's a ballerina, and so I've got access to kind of that world of dance, and we talked about sustainability, so one of the things that eventually I'll be looking at is to develop into setting up my own sustainable dancewear brand, but I'm not quite there yet, and I've still got quite a bit of work to do with ASICS and some exciting projects coming up with Size in the near future, so it's not going to be in the immediate term, but I do have more of a plan now, so yeah, thanks for asking.
It's incredible to hear that fire still hasn't left you, and you still want to push on and achieve something completely new and go into a whole different area. I think that's so important.
Yeah, thanks, Alex. One thing I spoke to you about earlier, I think, or it might have been one of your colleagues, Jamie and Dan, two of your colleagues rather. It's really important that you don't see this, I don't know what stage you're up to in your careers, although I'm presuming that some of you will have graduated and some of you will still be working your way through your courses. But it's really important that you don't see this as like the end of a journey, that you just see this as like this is the groundwork to get you to where you want to be, and then the fun's going to start after that and you really become who you want to be. And so for me, when you're asking me about what I'm looking for, I'm looking for a curious mind, I'm looking for someone who's going to challenge things and also ask questions, but they don't have to be the right questions. No question is stupid. Well, some questions are a bit stupid. But yeah, a curious mind and having a growth mindset. So not thinking, I can't do that because, thinking, I might try that because it might open this door for me, or it might open that door for me. And I found that when I've sometimes put my foot out of that security blanket or that comfort blanket and done something that's really pushed me, even though I felt quite uncomfortable, it's usually paid off and I've grown as a result. Started to go a bit psychotherapy on ourselves then, didn't we?
Not to worry at all. Any more questions, guys? Don't be shy. No, you've not got a question, you just got the mic. Okay. Anyone else? Anything to do with ASICS at all? Oh, at the back there.
You, sir, back.
Introduce yourself, tell us who you are.
Hi, my name is Jamie, I work at Size. I'm just wondering, Helen, what's your powers and onus as working ASICS?
The day we met.
Good question.
Was that the right answer?
No, go again.
Honestly, my priority moments were, did you say my priority?
Proudest,
okay, well, yeah. Proudest moments. Okay, so can I have two? So the first one was the first time that I took the SICE team to our head office in Kobe, and we touched down after I'd had 11 hours sleep, but they'd not had any sleep. And we went straight to the head office, and it was such a cultural shock arriving in Japan. And our minds were so open to the possibilities and spending a week in the head office, we weren't in the head office, but I mean in the city and the homeland of assets. It was just an incredible experience. Also, we got the opportunity to have a look at the sneakers in the assets archive. And I think that that was a great moment for me to share with the SICE team. The other one was for another one of your brands in the JD Group, which was when I worked with Daniel on the front row, and we worked with Novelist, who I'm sure some of you will know, Mercury Music nominated artist, and that was a very proud moment for me to be able to carry out a campaign with JD Sports and work alongside Novelist for the gel quantum last year.
That was a recent campaign, wasn't it?
It was fairly recent, yeah. It was at the back end of last year, and that work, he's such an incredible guy to work with, and I think we all got an immense amount out of that opportunity to work with him, and also to promote a really great shoe for Quantum 360 along the way.
Finally, what do you want your legacy to be at Asics? What do you want to kind of look back in time and say, this is what I achieved?
I'm really dying at this moment now, but just give me a second and I'll try to think of something authentic for me. I'd like to think that I've been involved in some really creative projects, and that I also inspired the others that I've been working alongside to go on and do great things and better things with the with their own careers. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's fine. If that's what you're going to let me
think. Yeah.
I tell you what, is there any words of wisdom or advice that you can give any of the graduates in the room going forward from today?
Okay. So I've always found that it's better to be in a job than not in a job. So if you get an opportunity and you're not quite sure and it's not perfect, but you can see some benefits and opportunities that may arise out of that, I think then you need to go for it, because you've got things to talk about when you go on to other interviews, when you go to networking events, you've got things to say. But if you sat at home and you're just scrolling through LinkedIn or whatever you do to look at opportunities, then you're not actively doing anything at that moment. You're not doing anything about it. So that would be one piece of advice.
What's the
advice? Just any words of wisdom or words of advice anyone going forward?
I'm not sure how wise that was to share that one, but I do think that it's always good to be in a job if you can. And also, don't judge people immediately when you meet them. In the past, I've often made mistakes because I immediately judge people because I thought this person's not going to be able to do this, or I don't think I'm able to trust that person. I think that you have to be kind to people and give everyone a chance, and maybe they approach projects in a different way to you. But really, it's about having an open mind as to what that person might be carrying on with them, or how they go about their daily life. But you've just got to be open-minded, and hopefully you'll flourish.
Amazing. Helen, thank you very, very much for joining us today.
Oh,